Hello and welcome to the Das Nostalgia Podcast, episode 8. I'm your host, Anatoly, and today I have another wonderful guest joining me in this virtual studio via the magic of the internet. Sir, please introduce yourself.
Hello, I am the Space Quest historian, also commonly known as Trolls or Trollsklimat in my native language. Have fun with that. I was the community manager for the Space Venture, the Two Guys from Andromeda's Kickstarter, and I am now the writer's intern, working under the heavy iron hand of Scott Murphy, putting lines of dialogue into the Space Venture, which is an awful lot of fun. And I'm also doing a little game thing with Frederik Olsen, who you might remember from the Space Quest fan game Valhalla Strikes Back, and Augustin Cordes, who is currently doing the Asylum thing that was kickstarted successfully, and he's done a game called Scratches earlier, which the game we're doing is called The Agency, and it's coming out whenever we feel like it. And that's basically it. I'm also a communications social media guy in my, I was going to say free time. This is actually my day job. That's basically it. I'm also very, very tall.
Awesome. We are here with Trolls today to talk about Space Quest series. I guess we're going to start in the beginning.
In the beginning, there was DOS.
Yes.
And in the beginning, there was AGI graphics. And two guys from Andromeda sat down and did Space Quest 1, the Sarian Encounter.
So, 1986, Space Quest arrives. So, I love that game. It's actually one of the first adventure games ever translated into Russian. Somewhat, I guess. So we have, just like every other Sierra game at that time, we have sort of AGI engine with the
16 color graphics
at max, but of course CGA and monochrome supported. Your one channel speaker sound or three channel sound on a Tandy compatible machine. And yeah, you know, all the other Sierra games, the horizontal resolution was halved in the engine, thus resulting even in the blockier graphics than EGA was capable of. But that was not really a problem. You know, we have just played, I guess Sierra's, a couple of Sierra's King's Quest games at that point. And here arrives Space Quest, and I think what it does different, I mean, the main difference from other sort of adventure games at the time, is that it was funny.
Yes, one of the hallmarks of early adventure gaming was that everything was taken really very seriously. I mean, I know, you know, very early text adventures like the Zork games, early Infocom games had humor in it. And, you know, the Planetfall games from Infocom also featured a space janitor. But Space Quest was really the first graphic adventure game that did not take itself so damn serious. Like, it was, from the two guys' standpoint, it was supposed to be the antithesis of the King's Quest series, which, you know, God love the King's Quest series, and it was one of the pioneers with the graphic adventure game genre, and it basically, you know, ushered in this era of graphic adventure games that every graphic adventure game from that point on has built upon. But it took itself so damn seriously. And the two guys were basically out to do a complete antithesis of the King's Quest series. So sci-fi comedy, not a huge thing back in the mid to late 80s, but they went ahead and did it anyway. And thank God for that.
I do. I really like that angle. I also like how especially well it's sort of revealed in the intro, which has about 3 pages of text on it,
yeah,
outlining the story. A story that's so, I guess, kind of trivial and useless that it's really, I like, you can really describe it in like a sentence.
And I'll try.
Yeah, okay, but the thing is, like, once you get past like the two pages of introductory text, which is really serious, on the third page, because it outlines what. Okay, fine, we'll go through the story. So, there's a Starship Arcata that's carrying what's that called?
The star generator.
The star generator device to revive planets into suns. And here there's another mysterious ship that's about to attack it, and that's what's being told to you in the first two screens of introductory text. And once you get to the third page, it says you serve on the Arcata as a janitor, and it pauses and skips a line and says, that's right, a janitor. And I guess it's all really all downhill from there, because not only Space Quest was just generally funny, I think the humor was sort of like of a self-deprecating, sarcastic kind. Yes. Which was somewhat unusual.
Yes, and I just have to, there's one thing nagging me. It doesn't turn planets into suns. Actually, the sun of the solar system is dying out, so they have to reignite the sun itself. Minor detail, I know, but it's going to nag me throughout the entire podcast if we don't correct that.
That's fine. I don't care.
Historian things. Yeah.
All right. Well,
but you're right. You're right. Absolutely right. It does have that self-deprecating kind of right. You're a janitor, and not only that, you're terrible at it.
You're terrible. Like, I think the first window that pops up is the first description line of the actual game was like, you have just completed one of your infamous naps in a janitor's closet.
Yes.
Or something along those lines.
Yes.
So, janitor
at all. He just basically sleeps away the day and doesn't actually do the job he's supposed to. And most of the people on the crew doesn't even like him.
That's why I love those sort of like some. One of my favorite jokes is actually when you get into the pod. And you look around before the takeoff. It's like the messages it gives you, like, what's all those switches and buttons? Now you wish you paid attention in class. Exactly. So, like, the whole game is basically like that. Every time you look at something, you pick up something, you get some kind of a sort of snarky remark. Before we get into, so what do you like about the first Space Quest game?
Well, actually, one of the things that you just mentioned was that even in this early incarnation of Space Quest, where you could name the character yourself, and if you didn't, if you just hit enter when it said please enter your name, it would default to Roger Wilco, and that was the name that they kept on using for the sequels. But even in this early incarnation, they right off the bat they tell you that you're not a hero, you're not even good at your job. You're Scott calls this the path of least resistance kind of guy. And that is exactly what Roger is. He's basically woken up from a nap. He's not even doing his job. He's just woken up from a nap. All his crew, fellow crew members are dead. There's an invasion going on. Not only that, the self-destruct mechanism has been activated. And you're just going, oh, shit. I should probably get out of here. Not that I want to. I was just coasting along on this job. I don't even want to go on this adventure, but I have to. And basically, what happens throughout the entire game and what happens throughout the entire sequel, Vohol's Revenge, which we'll get to, is that basically Roger just wants to go back to sleep. He's not out to save the universe. He's not out to get the princess. He's not out to do anything at all. He's just basically thrust into this unwillingly. And I thought that was such a refreshing thing about the whole atmosphere of the game, is that you're not a willing protagonist. You're not a willing hero, at least. You're this guy who's thrust into this, and again, that was such a refreshing thing as opposed to the King's Quest kind of swords and chivalry and all this stuff, which I to this day cannot really wrap my head around. I cannot watch Game of Thrones. I have never watched a Lord of the Rings movie without falling asleep. I can't get into the whole chivalry, I'm the hero, I'm going to save everyone kind of thing. So that's what really appealed to me about Space Quest right off the bat.
Yeah, I'd say this was a serious main appeal is the humor in a sci-fi graphic adventure game. I mean, right here we have to kind of make a stop. a little bit, and because this is going to cover pretty much all of the games, and this is for some of the listeners who are not familiar with the Sierra way of the adventure game.
Right.
I think we have to make this long remark that we're going to kind of discard certain things about it, because Sierra adventure games are generally, how would I put it? Nicely, I mean, have now years later come to realize that basically all the usual tricks of CR adventures are kind of by the book things of definitions of bad design, essentially. So Space Quest was no different. So in all of those games, and earlier ones more so, I guess, you would have insta-deaths, like permadeaths, every few, almost on every screen. You could have dead ends of various kinds, illogical puzzles, arcade sequences.
The arcade sequences, we'll have to get back to that. Yeah. But yeah,
and just sort of, it's just sort of various sort of dexterity tests, not necessarily the arcade sequences, just certain things, and the first one is not excluded here. So I would say we're not really going to bitch about these things, because back then, A, we didn't know any better. B, those are sort of how those Sierra games were played. So we are now generally also accepting all of those as a product of a different time. As infuriating as those things were, they are basically part of the gameplay, and they're what makes Sierra games stand out. Like, you, when you bought a Sierra game, you knew that those are the sort of things that you would need to deal with and avoid them. And all of those games, every single Space Quest game has those things. So I think we can just cover them into one big sort of but still loving anti-Sierra speech. I grew up on Sierra Adventure games. I love them. I love them to death, and I love playing them, and thank God I can now play them somewhat painlessly just because I know what to do. Back then that was not the case, especially before the internet, and I also lived in one of those countries where there's no way in hell I was calling, the other continent to get hints. So yeah, it was pretty difficult, pretty tough, and a lot of those, having just replayed Space Quest 1, a lot of early Sierra Adventure games also kind of based on you pre-solving the puzzle. You often put in situations where you either die or your progress is really impeded, but the chance of you to sort of pick out the solution was way earlier in the game, which often could lead to a dead end, but sometimes it didn't, so, like, lots of backtracking.
And a lot of saving and restoring.
Yes, a lot of saving and restoring, just because anything could kill you. Walking off a ledge would kill you, like, sitting, punching the wrong code into something would kill you. Waiting sometimes for too long would make you sort of, when the timer run out on a crucial event and you wouldn't be able to progress. So all those things, yes, unfair and really kind of shitty. But
from a modern perspective,
yes,
obviously.
Again, years later we kind of realized it was a bad thing, but back then it was part of it. It was part of the fun in many ways, kind of. I know for people who've never played those or never grew up with them, that would probably seem very, very strange that such a, I don't know, masochistic tendency would be enjoyable, but it was what it was. So all those games have those problems, and we're not really going to mention them unless there are some really specifically, standout examples, of which there are
plenty. There are plenty.
There are plenty.
Yes, and I don't know. I'm not going to jump to the defense of the old style Sierra school of design. If you pick up a LucasArts game in the if you picked up a LucasArts game in the early 90s, mid 90s, in the manual, they would actually have this little paragraph that read our game design philosophy, and it was basically just a punchy barb at the Sierra game philosophy. LucasArts would write, well, we're not going to leave you in an unwinnable state. We're not going to kill you because you poked your head into a room you weren't supposed to, or if you picked up a sharp object.
Right.
Basically,
right.
What LucasArts did was refine the adventure game design philosophy. However, in sort of a defense of the, we have to look at this from a historical perspective. Sierra were coming off of the interactive fiction, the old Infocom adventures, which were also barbaric in some of their design philosophies, and this was sort of part and parcel for playing a computer game. You have to remember, back in those days, we didn't have, if we wanted to play an arcade game, if you wanted to have quick trigger fingers or whatever, you'd go to an arcade hall. If you were at home playing on a personal computer, we were used to text adventures pretty much throughout the 80s. It wasn't until the late 80s that King's Quest came along. Well, actually, Mystery House came along, and then some of the early Sierra adventures were those that we would call graphic adventures. To the earliest graphic adventures were actually just text adventures with a screen of graphics either did or did not show what was actually going on in the text. And the very early AGI games, of which the Sarian Encounter is one of them, is coming off of that game design philosophy of, well, we have to describe everything that's going on, and every misstep that you can do is going to punish you. And then over the years, we sort of refined this, and you're absolutely right. Sierra did sort of get stuck in this. Well, we're coming off this grand history of game design philosophy, where they can be unfair, but hey, so is life.
I'm not sure if I entirely agree, because I also think the reason for this is largely economical, because Sierra made a shit ton of money selling hintbooks. We have now been told that in some cases, hintbooks sold more money, brought in more revenue than some of the games because of piracy. So I think it was always beneficial for Sierra Games to sort of put you in those states because you would need a hintbook or call a hint line, and not the fact that it didn't catch up. Because if you look at LucasArts, look how fast they caught on, because really, if there are two games that could be sort of you can die or have an unwinnable state, are the two earliest ones, the Maniac Mansion and Zach McCracken. Anything after that point, which were both in the early 80s, late 80s, they sort of moved on to sort of concentrating on other things, while Sierra sort of always stuck to sort of quantity of everything. Like, Sierra games were always full of content. There was any LucasArts adventure that you can pick. Any Sierra game easily had like double amount of rooms or characters or whatever, insane amount of animation. Sierra always went all out when it came to sort of quantity of things. So like lots of puzzles, lots of everything, but that sort of also multiplied your dead ends, your deaths, your everything, really. So Sierra always went all out with its resources, without really a concern for sort of genre progression, because that's kind of what they did. I always think it's unfair to compare the two companies, because they obviously both had very different goals.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, from the company's standpoint, yeah, I can sort of agree that LucasArts were the first to actually define a game design philosophy. I think Sierra didn't even have a game design philosophy per se. They just think, okay, we're building an adventure game. We're going to concentrate on putting in graphics first, and we're going to refine the parser, and we're going to have the character move around on screen. And the actual design and writing of the game is not as, we're not going to philosophize about that too much. We're just going to do what we've been doing so far. And LucasArts were pushing the envelope in terms of designing and thinking in terms of gameplay, another term that wasn't even in the vernacular back in the late 80s. They were, yeah, you know what I'm saying.
All right. I mean, I guess, what are the notable examples of bad puzzles in Space Quest 1? Well, actually, I mean, the one that really ticks me off is not really a puzzle, but there's a timed sequence where you go through the cave and you have to avoid the acid drops.
Yes.
Was nice. But other than that, the rest of them seem to be in line with, those is just you know, like every other Sierra game. So you've constantly fallen off ledges and just die. And there is a fair share of there's I think two or three puzzles where you're supposed to get the object or do something before the
Right.
event occurs, otherwise, you know, making you die or putting you into a dead end. So yeah, but the first space quest is also kind of small and very linear. So that sort of that makes those things slightly easier. So that's kind of my negative look on the first space quest. It really isn't much.
When we talk about arcade sequences, and when we talk about the dreaded arcade sequence, and when we talk about timed events, like if you when you're on Corona and if you walk around the desert, Roger gets thirsty and you have to drink from the bottle of dehydrated water, which, okay, I'm gonna get back to that. Those were some of the first that was a pioneering thing. They were the first to do that, and the skimmer sequence, which everybody apparently hates now, was actually the first true arcade sequence in an adventure game.
Oh, that's true.
But we can get back to really, really bad puzzles if we want to cover all the negative stuff first.
No, I mean, unless they really stand out, like I don't really feel the need of pointing out the, you know, the obvious.
I am going to point out one thing though. And this is, I think, Jess Morissette, the owner of the Virtual Broom Closet, which was the first Space Quest fan site. He will definitely agree with me on this. The one completely unfair puzzle in Space Quest 1 was that you needed a glass shard to deactivate some laser beams
Yep,
in a subterranean cave.
way later on.
Way later on. Let's just
But you couldn't backtrack to that point,
you couldn't
so
backtrack,
yeah.
exactly. And you had no idea that there was a glass shard in the crashed spaceship or the crashed shuttle that you arrived on the planet on. The windshield is broken, okay, but in front of the windshield is actually a glass shard that you're supposed to pick up and carry with you, then go down the secret elevator, then go to the laser beams, and then deactivate the laser beams with this glass shard. And you can't go back up the elevator to go back and pick up the glass. And Jess told me that he was stuck on this shit for months. And that is, you know, this is one of those things where if this has happened in an Infocom adventure game, if this has happened in any you know earlier types of adventure games, this would be part and parcel for it. There was a lot of backtracking in early interactive fiction. There was a lot of backtracking. There was a lot of dead ends. And there was a lot of saving and restoring. And this was the design philosophy, quote unquote, that Sierra were carrying on. Once we get into the later games of the series, you can see this kind of being chipped away, but you can also see kind of a conservatism in the design philosophy, in that we're not going to be all cuddly-wuddly like the LucasArts games are. You know, there's
Right.
this perceived rivalry between Sierra and LucasArts, which wasn't real.
Well, again, also, I think it sort of added to the whole humorous aspect because every time you would die or something would happen, you would get like another sort of snarky remark, and back in the game you go. Now, would we briefly, well, not so briefly, covered the bad? What is the good, in your opinion?
Oh, the good things about Space Quest 1. Well, oh shit. Well, apart from pioneering some things that later adventure games, not just Sierra games, but later adventure games in general, would attribute to Space Quest, like, for instance, the arcade sequence and timed events. The fact that it had a story wherein you were the unwilling protagonist, I've already mentioned that, but also you end up sort of being this unwitting hero where you end up saving the entire galaxy kind of by accident. And we've had this long, long discussion in the Space Quest fan community whether or not we can actually call Roger Wilco a hero, because there's one point in the game where you're on this desert planet Corona, and you reach Yulin's Flats, which is kind of this space bar divey kind of little water hole in the middle of the desert. Think Mos Eisley from the first Star Wars movie. Yes, the first. And you're supposed to get on the ship, and you're supposed to go to the spaceship that attacked the Archaea, which is called the Deltor, which is this it's the bad guy's spaceship, and you're supposed to go there, and you're supposed to retrieve the star generator, and at that point, I suppose people are under the assumption that Roger Wilco becomes a hero because he realizes that he has to go to this evil spaceship and retrieve the star generator, or at least set it to self-destruct, which is what you end up doing, because he realizes for some reason that if he doesn't do that, then nobody will. And that's actually precisely what I think makes him not a hero, is because once you get into your spaceship and you go off to find this Deltor thing, you can actually choose to turn your tail and run, which would be, in character for Roger Wilco, would be the first thing you would think of. You'd just go, nope, this is somebody else's problem. Screw it. I am not even going to go there. And if you do that, it plays a death message and says, well, unless you do this, well, your entire solar system is fucked, basically. So he has no choice other than to go into a dangerous situation that he doesn't want to be in. And I thought that was so refreshing, as opposed to the traditional, I am the hero, I have a huge sword, I'm going to get the princess, and all this stuff. And that was one, like in broader terms, that's what I really, really enjoyed about the first game. And then, of course, there's the graphics. Then there's the technical side. The graphics were drawn by Mark Crowe, who previously, actually Scott Murphy and Mark Crowe met while they were doing The Black Cauldron, which was a game based off a Disney movie that I've never seen. And Mark Crowe was one of the most talented graphic artists at Sierra at the time. And Space Quest 1, I mean, it looks primitive today, but for the time, it was colorful, my accent just crept in. It was colorful and it was varied, the desert planet is one thing, the spaceship you start out with is all in blue tones, but the desert planet is all yellow tones, and once you get to the space dive and the space bar, it's all red, and it looks really, really seedy, and once you get aboard the spaceship at the end, the Deltor, it all turns sort of green and red, and it was really, really varied and colorful, and also the character animation, something that really hadn't been, you know, explored fully. There was actually a lot of character animation in Space Quest 1, and extraneous character animation. There's one hole on Corona that you can poke your head into, and Roger actually, you know, you can watch him on screen poke his head in and get sucked into this hole, and all his, you know, his bones come flying out of this hole again. And it's one of those gratuitous death sequences, obviously, but it was just, yeah. That was really great. And the final thing, of course, is that Space Quest rewarded you for being stupid. If you fell off a cliff, if you got eaten by the Orad, if you poked your head into this fucking hole and you weren't supposed to, not only did it look spectacular, but it would come out and actually, well, sort of berate you, but in a funny way. And this is what led to death hunting in Space Quest. You would actually go out of your way to see, how can I get the main character killed? In a sort of a, like you said, it had a masochistic side to it, but it also had a sadistic side to it. You would actually go out of your way to try to get Roger killed, just to see what would happen. And all of these things were so refreshing. That's what I really loved about the first game.
I mean, I agree. By nowadays, it looks a bit antiquated and it plays a bit antiquated, but it's still like a sort of like a good example of an early graphic adventure game. It really does work, and it's funny. Actually, there isn't that much text in it. Now, again, like recently revisiting it, I was like, there's not a lot going on in that game. But it sort of set the template for what came afterwards. It had enough sort of those big elements to define the series that would follow. And and with that, I guess we can move on to. Next year, just a year after the second game arrived in the series, I think as far as fan favorites go, probably the least, right? Is it like the most hated of Space Quests is the second one?
I know.
I kind of always feel that was kind of unfair to it. I actually dig Space Quest 2 in as much that, yes, it's kind of largely... a retread of the first game with almost no improvement, and in fact kind of sometimes stepping backwards in many ways, especially when it comes to unfair deaths and dexterity tests and everything that seems to be just full of them. But largely, yeah, not a lot of improvement. But what do you think?
No, not sure. I'd agree on that. First of all, the graphics are way improved. And second of all, there's a lot more forethought put into Space Quest 2 than there is 1. I mean, 1 is seat-of-your-pants design thing. I mean, Space Quest 1 was invented in the way that the first four rooms of the Arcata were the tech demo that the two guys did on their own before they showed that to Ken Williams. And first off, Ken was like, "Yeah, space comedy, that's not really going to work." All right, I'll take a look at these four rooms you put together. And there's Roger going in and out of an elevator and going, "All right, you guys build the game." And they just go, "All right, we've got four rooms aboard a starship. Let's make a game out of that." So it's kind of seat of your pants design for the first game. The second game, there's a bit more forethought. You could argue that the story is kind of a retread of the first one. Roger gets stranded on a planet and he has to get out of there. But the second one actually has a clear antagonist. You actually have a clear goal for once. Because in the first game, you're just like, okay, where the fuck do I go now? What do I do now? How do I get off this fucking planet? In the second one, you're kind of going, all right, I've been kidnapped and this dude wants to kill me. So I really have to get the fuck home. And then stuff happens, which, for those of you who haven't played it, one or two of you, I'm not going to spoil it too much, but he ends up taking control of your starship, and then you end up in this final confrontation scene. So there's actually more of a cohesive story to it. And on the tech side, yes, there are more of these infuriating dead ends, and there are more of these, your character has to be in the exact same spot. There's the root monster. Everyone loves the root monster.
I don't mind it. I think Space Quest 2 is kind of unfairly maligned, especially even more so now since I haven't replayed Space Quest 2 because it's still somewhat fresh in my memory. I played it like 5 years ago. But having just replayed the first one, I mean, it feels like, they came out very close together, and I kind of feel that there was really no time to innovate or really to improve a lot. So it kind of, I think the first two games go really well together. I mean, the first game is really kind of primitive, and so is the second one.
Yeah, that is true. They're kind of building on each other, and it was such, I don't know what just crept in poetically there. It was such that the first game actually ended up doing really, really well, to much of the surprise of everyone at the company. So the second one was kind of, I'm not going to say rushed out, but that's basically it. It was like, all right, we have a hit on our hands, let's make a sequel.
Yeah, pretty much. And that's what it is. So I do honestly think, like, shit, are we going to just recommend all of them? Right, we are, right? All those games are available in Good Old Games, and I think they were, despite what some people might say about the second game, I also think if you're going to play the first one, you should also give the second one a shot. I mean, there isn't really much of a difference, at least to me. Yes, backgrounds are actually a lot prettier, and there's a lot more effects going on, like when you're like flying on the pod while you're with like two dudes behind you and stuff, there's some trees and you know, it's nicely animated. You can tell that there's a little bit more sort of care went into it in the presentation. There might have been a bit of a budget involved this time.
Side note, I know you have a point, but side note, Mark Rowe, who did all the graphics and animation for 1 and 2 and also 3, was actually, when he was doing 2, he was also drawing all the art and animation for the first Leisure Suit Larry game. So, dude basically got no sleep during that development time. Sorry, carry on.
Yeah, well, so I think we kind of can wrap up the second game, except for, like you've mentioned, it basically established the villain for the next I guess, right?
It's kind of a weird thing that
it, you he know, comes in and out.
Sludge Bohal, which is the villain of the second game and also the fourth game, he's sort of become the LeChuck of the series, which is kind of an unfair comparison because in Monkey Island, LeChuck is in every fucking game,
right?
Really. And Sludge Bohal really doesn't crop up that much, but somehow he's become this arch nemesis of Roger.
Pretty much because he's very prominently featured in two games and in one game, so much so, like, probably the most beloved amongst the fans. So I guess that would be the explanation for him being recognized as a serious villain.
I do have a personal story because Space Quest 2 was in fact the first adventure game I ever played, and I've said this on other podcasts, including Chris Pope's Guys from Andromeda podcast. When I was I must have been 7 or 8 years old, and I played this for the first time. I barely spoke any English. Space Quest 2. I was at a party my parents attended a party with a couple of their friends, and you know, you bring your kids to a party, you bring a 70-year-old kid to a party, and you basically go, okay, we're gonna go drink some red wine in the living room. What's the kid gonna do, right? We're gonna plunk him in front of the computer and put on whatever we've got. And in this case, it was Space Quest 2. And I was just poking around the first screen of Space Quest 2 when you're sweeping the outside of Xenon Orbital Station 4 with the broom there, and then just being able to go up and down walls. And I was actually thinking, all right, well, this is a tech demo of some sort. I'd had a Commodore 64. I'd watched a lot of tech demos and intros and stuff, and I thought, well, this is probably one of those because I can't seem to get anywhere. I had no idea that you can actually walk onto that little platform and it would whisk you into the station itself. I had no idea what to type into the parser because I couldn't speak English. And after that, my friend and I, my childhood friend Matthias and I, printed out a walkthrough. I have no idea where the hell we got this thing, but we printed out a walkthrough in an old dot matrix printer, which had the exact things you were supposed to type into it. And we basically beat the game that way. So that was my first adventure game ever. And by and large, we can thank Space Quest 2 for my incredible talents in the English language, because not only did it teach me how to construct basic rudimentary sentences in English, it also taught me the value of sarcasm. One of my absolute favorite deaths in Space Quest 2, we're talking about death hunting, one of my absolute favorite deaths is once you get to the jungle planet of Labion, there are these kind of cute looking mushroom things mm-hmm. on one screen, which if you get close to them, they'll eat you.
Mm-hmm.
And this huge wall of text will appear that describes how you are slowly being digested. And as you're being digested, it becomes sort of hallucinogenic because the digestive system of this plant induces some sort of hallucinogenic venom into you. Oh, look at all the pretty colors. And it was just this wall of text, actually several walls of text, which I just pissed myself laughing once I actually understood what was being said. That's one of my favorite, looking back on Space Quest 2, I have very, very fond memories of that. And I will wrap it up. I will actually jump to the defense of Space Quest 2 because, as you said, it's kind of been maligned as this the most unpopular Space Quest of all time. Looking back on it many, many years later, it actually wraps up the first two games in a very, very poetic way. It actually ends up with the denouement that you would expect from the first game. It's actually a very cohesive sequel because it ends up with Roger going to sleep in a cryogenic chamber. It's basically what you wanted out of the first game. You woke up in a janitor's closet, all you wanted to do was go back to sleep, and the second game ends with you actually getting to go back to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was so poetic.
You know what? Yeah, I do agree. So those two first games really sort of represent that era of adventure gaming, and together they go together well as well. So, and
right.
I guess this is it for Space Quest 2.
Yes,
because
yes,
we now can move on to
one thing.
Yes.
Is that Infamous Adventures, who are now Infamous Quests, did a fabulous remake, a VGA remake of Space Quest 2 in the style of Space Quest 4 with full voice acting and VGA graphics, retro VGA graphics, which is free to download. You should all check that out. It's absolutely brilliant. Thank you.
All right. So now we can move on to Space Quest 3. And before we even get into the story or anything else, Space Quest 3 sort of represents a part of a different age for Sierra, sort of the huge technology leap with the adoption of the SCI engine.
Yes.
You got proper high-res backgrounds in high-res EGA. You got support for multiple audio devices, including at that point an MT32, which is I didn't have and nobody I knew had, but now years later, or I can go back and re-listen to those things thanks to YouTube and people who were a lot richer than I was. All those things are really fantastic, and the leap in graphics is amazing. If you haven't played this game and you're listening to this, you should play it, of course, like just like you should play the rest of the games in the series, but play like the first two first and then go into the next one, to the third, and you'll see the massive technological leap forward.
Actually, you can play the third game if you're coming into the series fresh, and I'm guessing none of you listeners out there are, but if you were coming into the game fresh, if you want to introduce someone to Space Quest, actually put them in the chair and play Space Quest 3, because not only do you not really have to have the story of the first two games to enjoy Space Quest 3, it's also one of the shortest, and it's one of the easiest, quote-unquote, and it's also one of the most technologically impressive games of that era.
I'd say, and it's also, I'm kind of, that's pretty much the fan favorite, right, out of the series? For the most part, like, it's either 4 or 3 that people mostly pick.
Yes, or definitely.
Things got a little bit meta this time around. So why don't you tell us what the story is? Because this time there is actually again, not just technologically, but the game was like a move forward in every other way as well. Puzzle design, yes. Story, yes. Like everything in the 2 years that the game took to make, a whole lot of improvements have been made. So why don't you take it away, sir?
Thank you. Yes, we're talking 1989, and the SCI engine came out, as you said, and we had still 16 color graphics, but we're up to the 320x200 resolution. So pixels are actually pixels at this point. Graphically, there's a lot of dithering going on. There's a lot of shading going on. There's a lot of really, it almost has this comic book like feel to it, which they would carry on doing for 4 and 5.
I would say, I would quickly interject and say that I do consider Space Quest 3 to be one of the most beautiful EGA games. It sure deserves that, in my opinion.
Okay. Next to Loom, this is one of the best looking 16 color games I've ever played. And actually, if you go on YouTube, there's a time lapse thing. You can view a time lapse of what the engine actually does when it renders the background graphics. It's really impressive to watch, because what most people probably don't know or care about is that the background graphics for the SCI games are vector based
and AGI as well.
And AGI as well, but it renders these very, very quickly. Like you don't see it when you play the game, but it actually draws in all the vectors and then fills them in with color. And there's a time lapse on YouTube that you can search for, which it looks
it's really absolutely beautiful, and you can tell like the amount of detail is staggering.
It is staggering. All right, so onto the game itself. Mm-hmm. The thing about Space Quest 3 is, and I mentioned this in my Astro Chicken video that I did, which you can also find on YouTube, is that you can actually beat the game not knowing what the hell you're supposed to do. Because the plot that you mentioned, it gets very meta. You're supposed to rescue the two guys from Andromeda from captivity from a evil software company that's forcing them to churn out mindless arcade games instead of complex adventure games. But that plot is explained to you through this arcade game that you have to play in a Monolith Burger arcade machine called the Astro Chicken, which is a scourge upon Doug Oldfield, the programmer who invented this. My God, that chicken, that cock. Yes, but actually, once you sort of beat that game, the plot is explained to you. You get an SOS message from the two guys saying, please rescue us from Scumsoft, this evil software company. But you can go about your merry way and not beat this arcade machine and just go and finish the game not knowing that's what you're supposed to do. So basically, you can traipse through the whole game and just stumble along in a very Roger Wilco-ish sense, stumble upon everything you're supposed to do, basically being led on a string. I suppose your main motivation, as always, is that, at the start of the game, you wake up from your cryogenic slumber from Space Quest 2. You're aboard a trash freighter, and you're miles and light years away from home, and you basically just want to get back. That's your main motivation for playing the game. And you're stuck in this sector where you have no idea where the hell to go, so you go and visit Fester Blatz on Fleapod, who has no fucking... he has no good advice for you at all. He just sells you an Astro Chicken hat, and then this Arnold Annihilator crops up and wants you to pay for a whistle that you didn't pay for in Space Quest 2, and all these sort of things kind of get in your way for your main objective, which is just to get home. And what you end up with doing is accidentally kind of rescuing the two guys from Andromeda. And I say accidentally because if you did not play that arcade game very early in the game, you have no idea why you're doing all of this. So it's a very meta plot in that the creators themselves appear in the game and you have to rescue them. But it's also very meta in the sense that as far as having a main objective, all you're really doing is trying to get away from the game. In a sense, you just want to get home. You didn't ask for that Arnon and Annihilator to start chasing you around. You didn't ask to go to Ortega and buy a thermonuclear underwear so you can so you don't melt on this lava planet. And you didn't ask to go to the moon and rescue the two guys from the software company. You're just doing this because you want to get home.
Right. You know what? I agree. I'd say Space Quest 3 is certainly one of the best games in the series, and I'm not going to talk a lot about it. I'm just saying it's worth playing. And like I said, every aspect improved from the previous games, as well as the humor. Because honestly, the first two games really don't have that much text in it. They're relatively short as well. Third game really cranks it up. You can look at everything. There's plenty of descriptions going around. It's a lot funnier than the first two games, even though it's the same style of sort of sarcastic, snarky humor. You get a lot more out of the third game. Animations are spectacular, they're detailed, you know. And yeah, it's still obviously being a CR game has all those same issues that we recapped like half hour ago. But, you know, in Space Quest 3, it's one of those games where those things really kind of do, where they don't really matter. You can truly progress and enjoy the things. And if you die 55 million times, it really doesn't feel that punishing. That's really where the third game really comes around.
Exactly. They kind of found their voice. And one of the things they also introduced was the death scene. Like a text box shows up with a little picture of what happened when you died.
Right.
And with a little sarcastic description. And also there aren't that many... what you'd call unfair deaths. There's one in at the start of the game where there's a lot of, you know, pixel perfect maneuvering,
right.
And there's one in particular when you're climbing aboard the shuttle or the ship you're supposed to escape from the trash freighter with the aluminum mallard. Hello, Star Wars fans. Where if you climb on top of the ship and the game tells you it's slippery up here, better watch your step. And you're looking at the screen and going, well, that's a 2 meter drop at most. I mean, that's not going to kill you, is it? Yes, it is. Yes,
of course.
But by and large, there aren't any dead ends, and there aren't any unfair deaths. There are no glass shards from Space Quest 1, if you want to put it like that. There's no place where you were supposed to pick up an object, and you can go through the entire game and then realize, oh fuck, I forgot to pick up this and this.
Yeah, but I'd say this is pretty much me. Like Space Quest 3, highly recommended. As a piece of retro adventure gaming, as well as just an example of, you know, like a really fun Sierra game. Because some Sierra games can be not very fun.
Quest 5, anyone?
No, I love Space Quest 5.
I love Quest 5.
But before we get to Space Quest 5, I mean, I don't really have much to say about 3 anymore. Except for I give it 2 thumbs up and 3 thumbs up, whatever. Just...
Yeah, 3 thumbs.
Play it.
I'm not big on Russian anatomy. I will say one thing. You briefly mentioned the music and the sound. Technologically, yes, you could do the MT32 if you're rich enough to have one of those. It also had ad-lib sounds. It also supported different input devices. You had the mouse, which was completely useless at this point.
Mm-hmm.
But that comes into play later. It's still a parser game. You still have to type in, but it pauses the game when you type it in. And the music itself is composed by the drummer from Supertramp.
Oh.
Actually, it's the first game, at least to my knowledge, it's the first game that actually pulled in a renowned composer to do the soundtrack.
Didn't know that. Soundtrack is good. Very good. That whole opening sequence is pretty spectacular for 1989, I gotta say.
Pretty much fucking rocks, doesn't it?
Yeah. So, I guess that is it for 3. And now, again, we skip in 2 years. 2 years into the future, we go to the magical year of 1991. And here, once again, we make enough technological leaps to... Things really progressed back in the day, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
We
for good and for worse.
Yeah, so we now finally getting rid of the parser. You don't have to type things anymore. Everything is in this neat sort of Sierra pictogram interface where the panel drops up from the top with the sort of your available interactions. We graphically make a step into VGA, so now we can have 256 colors on screen at the same time. A variety of sound and music devices supported, with you being able to use different devices for music and sound, as well as the same device if you, again, were rich enough to have one of these. Or I guess it's the other way around, right? If you had like MT32, wouldn't make any sounds on it, all right? But whatever.
Actually, the music was composed for the MT32 and scaled down for the individual sound card sound.
As always, so. Like I think in Sierra case, it always makes sense to play it on the best MIDI device available to you. Because it sounds a lot better for the Sierra games. Really didn't bother with the really down conversion much, even back in the day where, you know, they could have made the PC speaker beep at different tones at the same time, kind of, but that was kind of you know, that was kind of just left on to the tansy, and you just get one single annoying tone of things on the IBM PC compatible. So pretty much the same further on. So yeah, they do sound better on like MT32 or any kind of general MIDI card. Sierra games, when it comes to sound, kind of stuck to the things, and it wouldn't like recompose for different devices. That was the issue. The sort of just sort of took a MIDI output and sort of approximated the output for like Adlib and stuff. In which case, like, you know, you play something like Police Quest 2 on MT32, sounds fucking mind blowing, and then you play it on the Adlib, which I love Adlib, but that soundtrack. A Police Quest 2 soundtrack sounds like somebody's like farting out the music. It's really not very good. So yeah, that's the deal with the Space Quest Sierra and just Sierra in general and music. Play it on the best available musical device.
Actually, yeah, the briefly just touching about the music, Space Quest 4 was actually when they started thinking, all right, we're gonna pull out the cinematics side of it. Oh, we're gonna have best graphics we can ever have. We're gonna have the best music we can ever have. This big, huge orchestra kind of score to it, which Ken Allen, who has later become a very good friend of mine. But it was basically, let's just pull out all the stops. To put it in a modern context, this is like what happens when you buy a new Crysis game or something, where you're, even though you have the souped-up computer that you bought last year and it just fucking rocked and all your friends were envious, and you buy the new Crysis game and it staggers to a halt. This is what Space Quest 4 was. It was one of those games that you bought not only to play and to enjoy, but also to impress your friends with.
Yeah, I mean, it looks gorgeous because, like, we are moving into graphically. I mean, now we have that sort of 90s staple Sierra sort of hand-drawn backgrounds that's been scanned in. And also, you know, hand-drawn animated sprites when they're large, but, you know, and they use the sort of rotoscoped sprites for movements and such.
Oh yes, video captured animation was just about to come out, yeah. And be.
Sierra certainly milked it. So like most of their animations are nice and smooth and rotoscoped from often unmatching weird angles. But we'll let that one slide. But like it looked spectacular for the time, especially hand drawn backgrounds. And like Space Quest 4 is rich with all kinds of animations, different camera angles, and just often on a time in 1991, a long time ago, it felt like an animated film. Very often.
And like an animated comic book, actually, it kind of resembles some of the earliest, like, I'm not going to say He-Man, but that's the first thing that came to mind.
Yeah, I guess
is that it has this sort of very Americanized, I'm going to say kind of angular, you know
yeah,
what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I do. I actually never thought about this until now, but yeah, it sure does. Also, we make again a leap in the story, because the setup for Space Quest 4 is kind of unusual. Is
humor
the yeah, again, it's very meta this time, and I guess the villain comes back, And the whole premise of the game is you travel into the future Space Quest games at first, eventually backtrack into to first Space Quest.
This is one of the things I so loved about this game was we were talking about how self-deprecating the Space Quest series actually is, and none more so than Space Quest IV.
Space Quest IV.
Where you're not talking about years, you're not talking about star dates, you're talking about Space Quest sequels. I am now traveling to Space Quest 12.
Yes.
I'm now traveling back to Space Quest 1. I mean, who comes up with that?
It's really clever, and it's all really, really funny. That's the most important thing of Space Quest is how funny. And Space Quest 4, like Space Quest 3 was funny, Space Quest 4 is like double funny that. And there seems to be a meta joke on like every corner about everything, about Seagear, about LucasArts, about Space Quest series on a whole, about the creators of the series, about other Seagear employees. It's chock full to this, and all of it is wrapped up into this sort of really good-looking, good-sounding sort of framework. Was very, very new. 1991 point-and-click interface. So we finally, the mouse was present in the SCI games, but was essentially useless. So here we have full mouse integration. So it was a new world for Sierra, and Space Quest IV is one of those, despite still having, again, all the usual issues of Sierra games. Sometimes I will say that Space Quest IV is a lot more unfair than Space Quest III.
It
has enough dead ends and fucking arbitrary deaths to, like, sometimes it feels that there's more than one per screen, and I think that there is, especially in the beginning. There's like three ways to die on every screen, which is I think is overdoing it a bit. But again, it now, not just the window with description, but you have like a little animation play out when you die, to go together with a snarky remark, and it all kind of did add up. Although I will say that I am not a fan of probably most of the puzzles in Space Quest IV myself, which is why I can, when people say it's apart from 3, this is probably the second one that people pick as their favorite. It's always like a toss up with the fans, which one is the best, either 3 or 4. And I would say like 4 has the majority of the puzzles are really obtuse.
You bring up two very, very good points that I really, really am itching to address.
Go ahead.
I'm going to take the last one first, which is the puzzles in it and the general unfairness of it, of the game. Basically, all of Space Quest IV is one huge timer puzzle. It doesn't have a global timer like Freddy Farkas, where if you don't complete the game in, 72 hours or something, you die for no explained reason. But every fucking screen has a timer on it where if you don't do something, something's going to come along and fucking outright kill you. So Space Quest IV is by far one of the most unforgiving Space Quest games of all time. This is not the game you want to sit down as a first-time player to play. What I do want to talk about is the icon interface, which you and so many others saw as a huge step forward, because now you had the mouse interface and you could use the mouse to control Roger around the screen. You had walk and look at and use and talk to, and also nose and the nose and the tongue icons, which were basically just there for laughs. They're not used to solve any puzzles. They're just there. If you click around the background with your nose and your tongue, you just basically get a funny message. The interesting thing about Space Quest IV is that it's one of the first Sierra games that uses the icon interface. This was pioneered with, I think, King's Quest IV. No, 5.
5.
5, yeah. I never played King's Quest. I think actually it was maybe the second Sierra game that used the icon interface. And here's a story about how that came to pass. And you can kind of tell this when playing Space Quest IV in retrospect. Space Quest IV was designed to have all of these bells and whistles, the VGA graphics and the sound and all of this stuff. But it was also designed as a parser game. The two guys were very much infatuated with the parser. They loved you being able to type stuff in and to hide jokes within the parser and use the parser as a means to communicate directly with the game. And they actually saw the icon interface as a step backwards. They did not want to use the icon interface for Space Quest IV. And there's actually a very disheartening story where Ken Williams calls the two guys into his office and says, right, we're doing Space Quest 4. You're already doing really well with the design document and the concept art and stuff. You now have a choice. Do you want Space Quest 4 to use the new icon interface that we pioneered with King's Quest 5, or do you want to still use the parser interface from Space Quest 3? And both of the two guys immediately responds, well, we want to use the parser interface. I mean, what the fuck? Why are you even asking? And Ken Williams goes, okay. And they go off and they design Space Quest 4. And I'm not sure about the chronology, but I think about halfway through the game, they get called back into Ken Williams' office. And he goes, right, well, you are using the icon interface. There are no ifs, when, and buts. You guys, here's the icon interface. You guys roll with it. And they're kind of, no. Nothing, you use the icon interface. And that's actually why the smell and taste icons are in the game, is because they'd written a bunch of messages. Actually, Josh Mandel wrote a bunch of the tongue and taste icons. sorry, the nose and taste icons messages, because there was no way to, poke around the backgrounds in the same sense with the icon interface. You had to, if you had an icon, you knew that this was used to operate, this was used to look at, this was used to talk to, and that's basically what you used to solve all the puzzles. But there was no extraneous exploring the world kind of thing. You couldn't walk up to a rock and type kick rock. You'd have to use the hand icon, which would either pick up the rock, push the rock, anything else, but never kick the rock. So that's actually why those two icons in there. And if the two guys had their will, Space Quest 4 would have been a parser game.
Interesting.
And that's my story. Yes, and then there's the unfairness. I'm just going to briefly touch upon that again. Is that by this time the two guys were actually kind of burned out. Space Quest 4, God love it. It has some of the darkest humor of the Space Quest series. It is brutal in some senses. Like you arrive in Space Quest 12 at the very start of the game. You arrive on your home planet. It is bombed to shit. There are these zombies walking around with these clockwork orange things in their eyes, and they shout at you, and they call upon this robot of death to come and kill you, and everything is just out to kill you. The entire game is basically out to kill you. Like I said, it's one huge timer puzzle. And this was pretty much the result of the two guys being sort of burned out, being told to do a Space Quest game right after the last Space Quest game shipped. Right, when are you doing the next Space Quest game? So they were kind of like, well, fuck you guys. We're going to do the toughest, hardest, in-your-face, fuck you kind of Space Quest we're going to do. And that was Space Quest 4. And God love it for it.
Yeah, I mean, it is a, I guess, an enjoyable game, but really difficult and obtuse puzzles, as far as I'm concerned. Because, like, I mean, as much as I like it, I think it certain things really do take away, at least for me personally. Because I remember playing it, like, originally, which for me wasn't 91, probably was sometime around 92. And, yeah, like, I died constantly. I was so frustrated. Like, all of that is still, to me, I mean, I don't have to play it like this now because I know what the solutions to the puzzles are. But, you know, it has, I mean, one of the first things in the game is, well, actually, there's, like, the first location in the game is fucking, it's pretty fucking awful. one of my most hated things is where you can pick up an object, which is what's some kind of a missile, right? Some kind of a,
the unstable ordnance.
Yes, that's right. And when you actually finally find sewer grate, and you live it, and you go into it, you explode because you're carrying that item.
Space Quest pioneered the dick move.
It's one of the biggest dick moves, and Space Quest 4 has quite a lot of these. And of course, when you put the ordnance back, it gives you, like, you wisely put it back and shit like that. We're just like, oh, you fucking snarky bastard, because you
that's your point too.
Like,
you
yes.
Pick- gives you a point, and you go, "All right, I'm gonna need this later." Kaboom! Yeah.
No, yes, it's Space Quest 4 is full of dick moves, and it's really kind of unfortunate. And for me, it really does take away from it. Like, I'd rather play Space Quest 3 than play Space Quest 4, no matter how beautiful and funny and meta it is. But it's a much larger game, has lots of content.
Of course, Space Quest 4 pioneered a lot of things in terms of graphics, in terms of sound, in terms of unforgiving puzzle design. But I still love it. Probably I'm a masochist too. But one other thing that it did was that it was one of the first Sierra games to have a CD-ROM release. As far as I know, it was actually the second game that Sierra did that had a CD-ROM release, a full talkie CD-ROM release, which had one or two prominent voices, and I'm going to say prominent in that they weren't Sierra employees that they just plunked down in front of the microphone. Roger Wilco was voiced by a dude that was, as far as I know, a cousin to Mark Siebert, who was the music producer for the game. And of course, the narrator we all know is Gary Owens, who was from a U.S. television show that I've never watched because I live in Scandinavia, called Laugh-In. But Space Quest 4 was my first introduction to the wonders that is Gary Owens. And forever, when I listen to the narrator in any Space Quest game, I will always picture Gary Owens sarcastically and sort of mock, what do you call it, like mock enthusiastically describing what you're doing and berating you at the same time. It was fantastic.
Yeah, I'd say it's the best. Although my personal preference, I in old games, I kind of prefer things to be silent where I read them because it's always funnier in my head. I will let the Space Quest 4 narrator slide, even though, you know, it has the usual sort of things with the voice narration where things are a tad too slow and everything like that, but because the intonation is nailed so perfectly, after a while, because at first I always hated it. Every time I play Space Quest 4 CD, I'm like, oh man, I can't wait to get through those dialogues. Eventually I just like, oh man, this is really funny.
And Space Quest 4 pioneered another dig move in the early CD-ROM eras, which was that you couldn't select subtitles and voice at the same time.
Yes.
Which is
very
really
annoying.
Terrible for us living in foreign countries who might not, not understand all the words, and also the voice quality is kind of low fidelity at this point, so it clips and you can't understand everything that's being said. Actually, there's a very interesting Easter egg. No, wait, I'm sorry. It's not an Easter egg. It's a glitch.
It's a bug that we call a feature. One of those cases.
It's great. Actually, I was going to say it's an Easter egg because in the voice file on the CD, you can listen to the entire voice file if you just put it in Audacity. There's actually the help guy. You know, when you look around the control panel, he just goes, "This button is for looking. This button, blah, blah, blah." He actually, if you look at the speech button, he goes, "This button is for toggling between speech and text." But in the audio file, there's actually a line that goes, "This button toggles between spoken messages, printed messages, or both." Oh. So it's actually in the fucking game at some point, and they took it out. And I have no idea why they did that.
Yeah, shame.
But the glitch we're talking about is that if you play the introduction and once the first text message pops up, "As we rejoin our friend and hero, Roger Wilco, da da da," if you press the space bar and then skip the introduction, you get text and speech at the same time.
Hmm. Excellent. Well,
and also if you install the new Rising Sun patch, which is out now, which was made many, many years later, it actually gives you the option to put text and speech in at the same time.
So I guess want to go over the differences since we're on the topic.
Oh, between the disc and the CD-ROM version?
Yep. Well, besides the obvious, you know, obviously every character is voiced. So some, you know, like we said, some good, some pretty badly, by the usual array of Sierra employees.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
no time to explain. We're both parking lot pizza.
Oh, that dude. Oh, that guy's an artist. His name escapes me. But please, if you visit the Galaxy Galleria and you go into the women's clothing store, Saks, please do whatever you can to piss off the clerk, because that is Jane Jensen of Gabriel Knight and Mobius fame.
That's pretty funny. That's pretty.
And the Monolith Burger guy is Josh Mandel. I love that. Yes, as for differences, they're actually quite plentiful. Yeah. I'm going to save the most egregious one for last.
There are some really like tiny ones, like the icons. The cursors are like in color. That's like a weird one to me.
Much of the graphic has been redrawn, actually.
And yes, a lot of the graphics are redone or rescanned, I guess.
No, they're actually completely redrawn.
Oh, they are?
Some things are just, have been processed differently. And most people actually prefer the graphics in the disc version.
I do.
Another feature of the new Rising Sun patch that you can download and install is that it takes all the assets from the disc version and then lets you play the CD version as if it was the disc version. Mm-hmm. The supercomputer that you see in the distance in the first screen when you arrive on Xenon in Space Quest 12 looks much different, and there's not so much blue fog, but it just looks crisper and it looks better, and the lightning that strikes it looks better. There are some other things that they took out because they were afraid of legal repercussions. Like in the Galaxy Galleria, there was a shop called Radio Shock, which is just an electronics outlet. And they changed that to, I gotta admit, this is one of my favorite puns, even though Scott Murphy hates puns. The store is now called Hurts So Good, as in H-Z So Good. And other little tiny things. There's actually a website somewhere, I can't remember the name of it. You can obviously look that up in the show notes, which explain all the differences between the disc and CD-ROM, all the graphical differences anyway. And then we move on to what is... we were talking about dick moves. This is perhaps the biggest dick move of Space Quest 4 ever.
Yep.
And it's a huge dick move because if you like me, you bought the Space Quest collection. I lived in Denmark around 1993, 4, whatever, 1994 probably. I bought the Space Quest collection. So I got all the first five games on one single CD-ROM. And it had Space Quest 4 on it, and it had Space Quest 4, the CD-ROM version on it. So my first real exposure to Space Quest 4 was just playing the CD-ROM version. And some genius went in and reprogrammed SCI, specifically the timer in SCI, to work in conjunction with your computer's speed rather than in some measurable increment. Like say, most timers will count out seconds or will count out milliseconds, but the Space Quest 4 CD-ROM timer works by just, you know, playing along with your computer speed.
Right, it's processor cycle dependent. As many games were in the 80s, for a 90s game, very unusual. Why those things were made, which is weird because sometimes it works kind of perfectly. I don't know, like for example, because the characters are now voiced, they all have now lip-synced animations. When they're close up, and those seem to go either extremely fast or actually sync up perfectly on every playthrough, and then they're always the same. But the actual game timer, and because there's so many timed events in this game, basically renders huge portions of the game impossible.
Exactly. It's absolutely impossible, and there was really no reason to do this, because if you had a computer that was fast enough to run a CD-ROM game, you had a computer that was fast enough to... did not need that. I think the reason they did that was because they thought, oh well, this game is so advanced that the computer's going to be busy reading all this data off the CD, which doesn't make any sense when you think about it. But
I'd say that adjustment would probably made for some kind of a different technical reason to implement something else, like it always happens, and then just broke the code. And again, you wouldn't notice unless you're really playing it on something, I guess, higher than the 386. Did it also crap out on 386s, or did you have to have a 486 and higher?
It moved like fucking roadkill on a 386. It was impossible to play. I actually asked the producer of the CD-ROM version was this guy named Dan Carver, and he's on Facebook. And I actually asked him, what genius thought of reprogramming the SCI engine? And he basically just shrugged and went, I have no idea. That was completely...
Sierra Engine got adjusted for basically each product individually. It's not like, you know, LucasArts had Scum that basically just had new features implemented, but the core of it stayed the same. If you actually compare all the CI games, especially from the early 90s, each one of them is tweaked, so there's so much hard-coded stuff in it. So, like, I'll let that slide, but it's
let it slide.
No, but it's totally a QA error that should have been caught. And something tells me it probably got implemented very late in the development, and that's why it went out like it did. But essentially, rendering, like, if you got a fast enough processor, the first section of the game was impossible before we even get to anything else. Because, again, there's, like I mentioned, there's about three ways to die on each screen in the first section.
At least.
So you got a patrol robot, you got a zombie. Those two appear constantly on the CD-ROM edition,
and that's not even counting once you get to the one that we've been dancing around so far. But we have to mention the sequence in the middle of the game.
Yeah, well, of course. Well, I'm just saying, in the beginning, in the first section of the game, right? Even if you manage to avoid the two robots on the higher timer speed, which damn near impossible, but you can hide from them. So that's kind of doable. At the end of it, you have to make it into the ship. That's impossible. That is it. Like, that's, you're done. If you had the CD-ROM version, and if you had anything higher than, like, I guess 486 or up, yeah. Right? You're screwed. You were not progressing, and you would never guess it. Like, if you've never played the floppy version before, that was the worst part. Is that you would have never, you were always, and being a Sierra game, you know, that's kind of what, where it all comes back to bite you in the ass, where it's like, well, it's a Sierra game, you expect to die, you expect to have sort of like very hard parts in the game, and you would just hopelessly replay that first section of the game, which became very difficult because now the amount of patrols is basically infinite. And you would never make it into a ship, and it seemed like you could do it. You always could be. You always were like just like a few pixels away, from the animation plane. But it was impossible.
You'd sit there and go, right? I must be doing something wrong because you know, you can sort of sense what it actually does. If you're trying to get into the patrol ship, is that there's a timer that runs out, and then the secret police are supposed to come in from the right and then shoot your ass. You only have like 3 or 4 seconds in the disc version to do it. Mm-hmm. Problem is, on the CD-ROM version, if your processor is too fast, the secret police dude is already there. And so you think, all right, this is a puzzle. I have to get around this guy somehow. And no, you don't. So at some point, you just sit there and go, all right, the graphics are nice, the sound is nice, this game is fucking impossible.
Yes, actually, a lot of people who, like, I actually hear it from a lot of Europeans who played LucasArts games but didn't know Sierra games. Like, Space Quest IV, I guess, was a major release enough over there for people to notice. So a lot of people bought Space Quest IV and quickly abandoned it because it's like, well, it's impossible, because CD release is impossible. And even if you somehow kind of, your machine is somewhere in the middle where you can avoid sequel police, then there is a bit in the middle of the game that that will make you furious, because
you throw your fucking computer out the window.
You will. It's essentially basically timer introduced a number of game breaking bugs. Which seemed like they were possible. And were they possible? I guess it depends on what kind of machine you had.
And the really, really disheartening thing is that actually, if you look at this from a game design standpoint, it does sort of make sense. It's brutal, and it's actually one of those things that I really hate about adventure games, is that you have a very, very short amount of time to do something. I really, really hate timer puzzles, but I love Space Quest IV for some reason. From a game design standpoint, it actually does make sense. You're being chased around this mall, and you have to go across the, I'm going to say it, Skate-O-Rama.
There you go.
To escape from these sequel policemen, and you're supposed to move into the upper dome and then go across and then go back down and steal a time pod. Problem is, if your computer's too fast and you're running the CD-ROM version, there is no way to get across that thing without getting shot to shit. And from a game design standpoint, it actually makes sense because you're being chased. But some programmer genius, and we've never managed to find out who it was, actually broke this part of the game. And the two guys are very much aware of just how unfair this part of the game is. And they will still say, right, it was a good puzzle when we thought of it. It might not have been a very fair puzzle. It might have been one of those stressful puzzles, but it made sense in the context of the game. Some programming asshole ruined it for us.
Yeah. Well, there you have it. I mean, granted, nowadays really isn't an issue because you can pretty much set the DOSBox to any cycle count that you want. And there is also, there has been now for like a fan patch available for like a decade now, maybe even over. Does that actually fix everything, or it's still kind of fiddly? Because I don't know.
No, the new Rising Sun patch, which is the one you're referring to, is the one that does this thing where it copies the assets from the disk version and then puts speech and stuff into it. It also fixes the timer bugs. But if you want the true CD-ROM experience, my advice is to just play through Scum VM, which actually plays Space Quest 4 and fixes the timer bugs.
You have it. I recommend Space Quest 4. I mean, we listed off enough annoyances about it. I mean, it's largely, besides 3, it's largely the fan favorite, despite probably having the most obtuse design of the whole series.
Yeah, and I think it's the fan favorite because despite all the things that we've been rattling on about now, how unfair it is and how much it depends on timer puzzles and such, all of that is really just a shit icing on a very, very delicious cake.
Yeah, absolutely. The setup is extremely unique. The dark humor combines extremely well with the sort of sarcastic side of it. So it all, like, as a sort of piece of the series, it works extremely well. You kind of would have to excuse a lot of the puzzles and backwards design to enjoy it, but you definitely will enjoy that whole sort of, I guess, the story aspect of it a lot more than the actual adventure game aspect of it.
Exactly, and just to cap off Space Quest 4, I'm going to get into personal territory here, but to me, Space Quest 4 was the last true Space Quest game. It was the last game that the two guys from Andromeda designed together, and it sort of caps off this quadrilogy that started with Space Quest 1 and ended with Space Quest 4. These are the four, I'm going to say, true Space Quest games. And we're going to get into why when we cover Space Quest 5 and 6, and also Space Quest 1 VGA. But if you really want the true Space Quest experience, it's Space Quest 1 through 4.
Yeah,
for my money.
I agree. Well, there it is. I guess we now can backtrack a year and return to the magical year of 1991, where the thing happened when Sierra started updating some of their early entries in their long-running series, and Space Quest 1 was not was no different. Now retitled like many remakes, Space Quest 1: Roger Wilco in Sarian Encounter.
Do you want to know why it was retitled Roger Wilco in the Sarian Encounter?
No. I mean, I don't know, but go ahead.
I'm going to tell you anyway.
Yes.
Actually, it turns out that the legal department at Sierra were, there was one guy in the legal department whose job it was to make sure that they weren't infringing on copyrights and stuff, and he was not very good at his job. He's the reason why Heroes Quest became Quest for Glory. And he's also the reason why nobody bothered to check whether Space Quest was actually a trademark used by anyone else. And it turns out that Space Quest was, in fact, a trademark used by a number of different companies or organizations or whatever. So they were actually actively trying to downplay the Space Quest part of it and try to make Roger Wilco the standout, catch thing for the Space Quest games. So there you have it.
Interesting. Didn't know that. Well, it's basically a graphic update. Not a graphic update. I think it's an update of the remake of the first game in what became the staple 90s Sierra thing. So VGA graphics, rotoscoped animations, and point and click control of characters. Structurally, it's the same game. However, because we sort of jumped two eras of development, now instead of just a sparse amount of text, now there's sort of an interactions and a snarky remark for everything, and it has been everything has been rewritten by I guess we now know Josh Mandel, although in the typical Sierra fashion, he is uncredited.
You're right. So many of the look messages, particularly on board the Arcata, sorry, my accent crept in again, go into much more detail about which crew member and so and such. But there's a lot of copy and paste as well. Mostly the additions are because you have the icon interface, yes. And you also have the smell and taste icons. Mm-hmm. And those were pretty much all of the text written that wasn't copy and pasted from the first game were written by the unofficial third guy from Andromeda, yeah. Josh Mandel.
And despite, I mean, I like the text. However, I don't really like the VGA remake. Like the case with me, there's pretty much every VGA update of a CR game, with the exception of maybe Leisure Suit Larry. I actually don't like these, and here's why. First of all, a lot of time has passed since the first Space Quest, and it's a really linear and unfair game. And I think putting it into a better technological context actually highlights those sort of ancient design philosophies.
Yes, they didn't do anything with the puzzles,
yeah,
per se.
Yeah, so like all of those things become, you know, they weren't problematic when it was 1986 and that's how things were done. I mean, 5 years later, things were slightly different. So sort of replaying the same set of puzzles is kind of, you know, it's sort of, you know, you remembered it better than it was. You know, it's better to look at it in its primitive state from 1986 then sort of have a graphic update. Also, I don't like the graphics. Something is slightly off. They don't really feel Space Questy to me. I don't really know how to explain it. I mean, they are like drawn backgrounds that are scanned in. Something about the color schemes and everything, especially like in contrast to Space Quest 4 that came out the same year, it's kind of, I don't know, really can't place it, because it's really trying to replicate Space Quest 4, right? Because it's sort of wrapping Space Quest 1 in that Space Quest 4 sort of format, and I think it's kind of failing.
And not even really. I do know why it doesn't feel very Space Quest-y.
Well, so do I now.
I suppose by and large the graphics are really pretty, but they don't feel Space Questy, like you say. And the problem, I'm just going to tell the story, even though you know it, is that Space Quest 1 was actually Space Quest 1 VGA was actually done without the express approval of the two guys from Andromeda. This was one of those things where Sierra was going, all right, we need to reintroduce audiences to our early games, and they're not going to sit down and play 16 color AGI games. They're going to want you know, icon interface and all this jazz. So they actually outsourced a lot of the graphics to Korean artists, I think. Here's a helpful hint, by the way. If you ever catch Scott Murphy on Twitter, never, ever, ever mention Space Quest 1 VGA.
Yeah, he's going to go on a big rant.
He is butthurt, and deservedly so, because basically Sierra went off and did Space Quest 1 VGA while the two guys were doing Space Quest 4. And they did call in Scott Murphy and Mark Crowe to sort of show them what they were doing, and going, all right, if you guys have any changes that you'd like to implement for the Space Quest 1 VGA updates, please let us know, and we'll see what we can do. So Scott Murphy goes off, and he writes this huge list that goes, I don't like that, I don't like that, that should be changed, and that doesn't work. And he hands this list off to them, and he gets, like a couple of weeks later, he gets a response back going, yeah, we can't do that. Hmm. Screw you.
Pretty interesting. Yeah, I'd say the VGA update, I mean, it's interesting from the historical point of view, kind of, but I'd say kind of skip it. It's really unnecessary, it's redundant, and it really doesn't add anything. I mean, if you want to read all the fun, and basically, like, the only fun in it is just, like, you're going to go through all the emotions, but while you are on every skin, you just pick a look or smell or taste icon and just start clicking on everything, because that's where really the new material is, and everything else is kind of unnecessary,
except for the music.
Oh yes, of course, yes. Ken Allen, right?
Ken Allen did a fantastic score for Space Quest 1 VGA.
Yes.
Basically, you should just fucking go to spacequest.net/archive and just download the fucking soundtrack and groove to that, because it is fantastic.
I forgot about that. I mean, and the graphics sometimes can be nice. They're kind of different. Like, I like all the sort of stop motioned objects in the intro that fly by, which clash weirdly with like hand painted parts of cutscenes. I mean, it has like the nice spaceship that sort of flies behind and in front of credits and stuff like that. So it's all kind of really, really neat, but it doesn't really feel like Space Quest. And again, I just think it's redundant. It's one of those remakes that I didn't really feel the need of updating. You know, every other remake kind of implemented different things. Like, people say the Leisure Suit Larry remake is redundant, but I'm like, oh man, Leisure Suit Larry like remake adds so much. Kind of.
You're talking about the first remake, the sort of
EGA to VGA, not the soft porn to EGA. But it's like, I love Leisure Suit Larry VGA. I really do. And even, you know, King's Quest update, SCI update also adds and changes a few things and stuff like this. The fucking Space Quest remake does nothing. I mean, the only one that's to me more useless than Space Quest is the Police Quest remake. And don't you fucking dare tell me in comments that you love Police Quest VGA. I'll fucking reach through the internet and smack your ass, because it's Police Quest VGA is fucking awful.
Thank God I never played Police Quest. All right, here's my final word on Space Quest 1 VGA. Here's where it completely goes off the chart for me, is that it's a retro game. It's a retro game in every sense of the word. Even the graphics are retro 50s style, very much. It looks like a colorized black and white movie. And it was not at all the forward-thinking kind of a game that Space Quest was, because the Space Quest games look quaint by today's standards, but back then they were always pushing the envelope. I remember Space Quest 4 was the first Sierra game that used color cycling, and actually Roberta Williams threw a shit fit when she found out that Space Quest 4 was the first game to use color cycling, because that was the technology that she wanted to use for King's Quest, and they actually kept it from her when they were doing Space Quest 4, because they thought, no, fuck it, King's Quest is not going to get this one up on us, because King's Quest was obviously the flagship of Sierra, and all the new technologies that were coming out, they put those into King's Quest games first. But no, Space Quest games did the color cycling thing first. And it you know, quaint little things, but they were always forward-thinking and always edge of technology kind of things. And Space Quest 1 VGA was just a retread and a retro kind of thing, and an anomaly in the Space Quest universe. There, that's it.
Yeah. Pretty much. So we can now move on to sort of a more controversial game in the series. Again, we jump 2 years. To 1993 it is. And we have sort of a weird situation happen where the original creators of the series split up. And not only that, the Space Quest V is developed by an entirely different company.
Yes.
A company called Dynamics, by that point a subsidiary of Sierra, which was known for such games as The Incredible Machine and a variety of simulators, of really good simulators. But in adventure, they also dabbled in adventures a little bit, and might be known to adventure players for Rise of the Dragon and Heart of China. Which are decent adventure games, really good looking. And under Mark Crow, they designed and made Space Quest V, published by CR. I fucking love that game. I do accept it as a different thing, like it, because I think it does so many things differently. It's easier for me to accept it as a sort of like a standalone thing, because with Dynamics, of course, comes in a completely different art style, the art style that was familiar to, you know, people who played Heart of China and Rise of the Dragon, sort of the sort of kind of very sort of paper painted look. I'm not an artist, so I don't know how to describe it, but That look, I
More
think,
comic book feel
yeah,
to
sort
it.
of like a really sort of comic booky feel, and I think it really works in Space Quest V. Humor changed from from sort of a dark, almost black humor of Space Quest IV into something really, really light. This time we actually have a more of a central spoof point because Space Quest IV being sci-fi comedy, of course, referenced so many things, right? The first game always went all over the place, down to like Blues Brothers and ZZ Top and stuff like that. But like with Space Quest V, you had that central theme of spoofing Star Trek. So
And
it
specifically
was a
the next
Star
generation.
yeah, so it was a Star Trek parody, largely right from the opening credits all the way throughout the game, and the game is structured differently. Before that, all the Space Quest games were kind of going through those right from the first game, I guess, in a way. It's set up this template where you sort of go into those different scenarios, standalone sort of sets of rooms, and you progress. Space Quest V kind of has a central hub in a way, where you, which is your ship, your garbage collecting ship, where you go on and do other missions. But I also think that Space Quest V is, together with the sort of parody angle and the new sort of humor direction, I think that to me, like, I actually think Space Quest V is really, really funny. To me, I think when I think of Space Quest V, the humor actually comes first before everything else, and then everything else, the graphics. I mean, the music is also amazing.
I completely agree that Space Quest V stands on its own,
And
really,
honestly, here's the thing
really.
that after I fucking shit on fan favorite Space Quest 4, I will say Space Quest 5 is actually the best designed game in the series. As if retroactively looking back at it, I will say that Space Quest 5 is has the minimum of annoying puzzles, dead ends, arbitrary deaths, and also most of the puzzles are a lot more intuitive than, let's say, Space Quest, well, especially 4, but just any, really. I don't know if you agree, but that's my kind of personal opinion on it. Like, to me, with the years, I know back in the day things didn't really seem like this, but like as time goes on and the more I look at it, because it used to be my favorite Space Quest of Space Quest 3, and probably kind of still is, but now that if I had to sit down and play, I would be like, you know what, I will probably really enjoy playing Space Quest 5 a lot more than I will enjoy Space Quest 3, just because it's easier to play, it flows better. I like looking at pretty pictures, listening to pretty music, and I sort of like the sort of really light-hearted, sort of humorous direction where you can just sort of like try command icon on everything and fucking see what happens.
I agree. On its own, it stands as a really, really well-designed game. It has a really good plot. It flows really well. It has a sort of, I'm not going to say cinematic quality to it, but it has sort of this comic book feel to it, where the cutscenes are an integral part of it. The puzzles are an integral part of what happens. Even the arcade sequence, the one where you have to rescue Cliffy in that little EVA fucking pod.
That actually plays surprisingly well for Sierra arcade sequence.
It does, unless you have a fast machine, but
Right. Yeah,
never mind.
whatever.
And you're absolutely right. It does have more of a lighthearted tone. What happened was that, like you said, the two guys from Andromeda split up. Mark Crow moved to Oregon. Sierra was based in Oakhurst in California, and Dynamics was based in Oregon. And Mark Crow moved to Oregon. And what Dynamics do really, really well are really, really fascinatingly good graphics. They're amazing at graphics. And what happened was that Sierra noticed that they were also doing adventure games. And Rise of the Dragon and Heart of China all use an internal adventure game engine that Dynamics developed. You'll notice when you play this, they don't play like Sierra Adventures, even though they're published under the Sierra banner. So Sierra were very interested in Dynamics. If these guys are going to do adventure games, let them use our adventure game engine. Let them use SCI. So Space Quest V was actually kind of a litmus test for Dynamics to see if these guys could do an SCI adventure game. So they just went, all right, we've got Space Quest V sort of in the wings. Josh Mandel and Bruce Balfour at Oakhurst are actually working on a design for Space Quest V, but we're going to give it to Mark Crow over in Oregon to see if Dynamics can actually do an adventure game in SCI. So And then Josh Mandel ended up doing Space Quest VI. We'll get to that. But what turns out is that Mark Crow, very visual kind of guy, very much into, I'm not going to say slapstick humor. One of the little known facts about the Space Quest series is that while Scott Murphy wrote most of the dialogue, most of the text and such, most of the actual plots, the overarching plots, were actually Mark Crow's story ideas, including Space Quest 3 and 4. In fact, Mark Crow will accept the blame for the incongruence of the Arnord Annihilator, who shows up in Space Quest 3 to beat you up for not paying for the Leviathan Terror Beast mating whistle in Space Quest 2, even though in Space Quest 2 it says that the whistle is actually free. He will accept the blame for that. Space Quest 5 is basically him working without the, acidic, sarcastic input of Scott Murphy. And actually, there's this dude at Dynamics who I have yet been unable to contact or find anywhere called David Selle, S-E-L-L-E, who basically took on Scott Murphy's role and wrote most of the dialogue and text for Space Quest 5. So that's basically Space Quest 5 in a nutshell. It's a more lighthearted, very, very beautiful looking, very, very, cohesive narrative, and populated with characters you can interact with. That's another thing. Most of the Space Quest 1 through 4, you're basically on your own for most of the game. In Space Quest 5, you've got a crew to order around, you got people to talk to, and there are dialogue cutscenes and all this stuff. That's pretty much what Space Quest 5 is.
Yeah, I'd say it gets the highest recommendation from me. And you can, it doesn't really rely on any of the tropes of the previous games. Like, it's pretty standalone. And I do think that as time goes on, it sort of stands out as sort of like the most well designed. So to me, it's really enjoyable. I like it, and yes, it's very different from the other games, but I would personally pick that one as my favorite for those reasons, just because I like playing it. It's really enjoyable and it's really funny. Like, I love the whole opening. Like, as shitty as the opening of Space Quest was, like, opening of Space Quest 5 is a complete opposite of that. Like, you get the test, which is beautiful, and like, so many unique Dynamics made so many unique assets just for that. You know what I'm saying? Like, you have the animated classroom, you have the test, you have the music, you can cheat. So it's full of those little touches, and even like the first, I guess, arcade sequence, which is not really an arcade sequence, when you mop the StarCon logo, is fucking amazingly hilarious. Followed by a really cool cutscene. So like, all of those things, and you also have like rotoscoped people, like big in cutscenes, you know, like the meeting and stuff like that. So it's like some sound Simpsons sound effects and everything. So it all really plays together well, and once you get to your ship and to the central hub and you actually go on the missions, it feels like the sort of it is very comedic. And yes, it over relies on the Star Trek thing, but I think it also works in its way. It works in its favor, sticking to mostly one parody, because I think it really adds to sort of the overall feel of that game being more lighthearted and more comedic, and also more again, more cohesive.
Yeah, and the reason they did the whole Star Trek parody thing was that in all of Space Quest's history from 1 to 4. It was pretty much, the first game is kind of a, you could argue it's a Star Trek 2 parody, a Wrath of Khan parody with the Star Generator and such, but pretty much they stuck to parodying Star Wars and other little, classic works of
there was never really science. Like a big focus. It always poked fun of just the tropes of the genre or specific references,
exactly,
where something would look like
everything,
something else, and like really just like it just poked at like every science fiction and not only sort of things, like all over the place, but it was never really sort of wrapped up in the one, none of the Space Quests were like, okay, now we're kind of in the Star Wars spoofy universe. It was never really the case until Space Quest 5.
Exactly. You're absolutely right. It was one of the things was that the early Space Quest 1 to 4 were no holds barred, and they would never they would, like you said, they would poke fun at science fiction tropes instead of poking fun at particular bits of science fiction. You'd have maybe a character crop up that would look like something out of a Star Wars movie, but it would never, you know, like you say, centralize around a central parodic theme. Is that even a word?
It's fine. Neither of us are, like, English is not doing my first language, or neither is my second language, to be honest. So, you know, there it is. We can be forgiven.
All right. But I will say about Space Quest V, it's a beautiful game. It's well designed. It's well written, actually. It has a ton of really beautiful animation. The soundtrack is fine. I have a little tidbit about the soundtrack I'll get into later. It really is, on its own, it's a standout game. It's just not very Space Questy to me, exactly because it does have that central parody theme. Because it doesn't veer out of its comfort zone. It doesn't mercilessly poke fun at everything in its path. It's just very, very much, it has a linear plot within a very linear parodic element, and it doesn't veer out of its comfort zone. All right, about the soundtrack. Mm-hmm. The soundtrack was composed by two dudes at Dynamics who did a very, very phenomenal soundtrack. I will say it is probably my third favorite soundtrack, right after Space Quest 4 and Space Quest 1 VGA, actually. It is really, really stand out. What most people probably don't know, if they didn't listen to my stupid little podcast, is that Ken Allen, who did Space Quest 4 and Space Quest 1 VGA, actually composed an entire soundtrack for Space Quest 5 that was, for one reason or another, thrown out. And the soundtrack you hear in Space Quest V, the one that was done by the Dynamics dudes, is actually kind of a last-minute thing. They actually threw that together in the last couple of months of development, and that just makes it all the more fucking impressive to me.
Yeah, that's because it's a damn good soundtrack.
It is. One last note about Space Quest V is that if you want people, if you're trying to introduce people to good science fiction comedy in general, I would say plunk them down and let them play Space Quest V. If they're Star Trek fans and they need to sort of be shaken out of their rosy red Gene Roddenberry fantasy of everyone gets along with everyone, let them play Space Quest V. It's a damn good game. But if you want them to introduce them to Space Quest, like the essence of Space Quest and what that is, let them play Space Quest III.
Three is probably the best. All right, so yeah, I guess this is it. Well, I guess we both said enough about Space Quest V. And we can now painfully move on to, again, we jump 2 years ahead to the year of 1995, where Space Quest VI, Roger Wilco in the Spinal Frontier, gets released.
CD-ROM only?
CD-ROM only, high-res SVGA, designed by a multitude of people for a variety of reasons. And as much as I've defended Space Quest 2 as people mostly pick it as the worst, and I defend it and say that it's probably, it's not. A lot of my personal thing is, a lot of people will defend Space Quest 6 or at least parts of it. I will say that's a Space Quest game I pretty much don't enjoy playing at all. For a variety of reasons. First of all, I don't like the feel. Like, I don't like anything about that game. I don't like the feel. I don't like the look. Like, I despise that fucking look. I don't like the story. I don't like the setup. I don't like the characters. I don't like the puzzles. I don't like how it falls apart halfway through. There's an obvious explanation for it, but I fucking don't like Space Quest 6 one bit. To me, kind of Space Quest series ends with 5, because to me that was a high note, and Space Quest 6 is such a big disappointment to me. I can't even bring myself to replay it. That's how little of it I enjoy. I mean, there's a few good gags there. Like, I fucking love the Windows gag. Again, it's one of those things which look really, really out of place.
Actually, for me, the Space Quest series ended at 4, to be perfectly honest.
Well, it's for many people. For many fans, and especially hardcore fans, Space Quest kind of ended at 4. And 5 is just, it's a good game, but it's not really Space Quest. To me, like, 5 really caps off that original sort of series before things really go to shit on Space Quest 6. I don't know, if you're going to defend Space Quest 6... in any way, do it now, because I'm basically all negative on that one.
I will say that first of all, I love Josh Mandel, and I love his writing, and I love the philosophy that he has towards game design, which is really, really immersive. He wants to immerse you in the game world. And if there's one thing that Space Quest VI does really well in the parts that he did, no offense to Scott Murphy, who took over the project after Josh left, I'll get into that, is that you can click on everything, and you can click every icon, every inventory icon, you can click everything on everything in the background, and it will give you a unique response. And he's very, very much into that. And Space Quest VI really comes together in the sense that you're exploring a world, and everything in that world has something to it. Even if it's just extraneous, even if you don't have to mess with it, it really does. It's a world to explore. I will agree with what you said, that Space Quest VI has a number of design problems. It has a fundamental story problem, first of all, which is that the story doesn't actually get going until about halfway through the game. You have no idea. The box tells you that you're going to be traipsing around inner space. You're going to be traipsing around the human body.
Right.
That doesn't even happen until at least halfway through the game, or maybe just three quarters of the way through the game. Until then, you're just bopping around doing whatever the hell. There's that. And then there's sort of a humor thing where you could argue that Space Quest V was incongruent in the way that it focused more on slapstick humor and more lighthearted comedy. Space Quest VI wants to be, you can sort of tell it wants to be a return to Space Quest IV in particular. It wants to be a return to that sort of sardonic, downtrodden sense of humor, but most of the writing comes from Josh Mandel, who is a very, very gifted, talented writer, but he's and he contributed a lot to Space Quest 1 VGA and Space Quest 4. All the game boxes in the software store in Space Quest 4 are Josh Mandel's. But it's on a whole, it just doesn't feel Space Questy. And he will probably be the first to admit this, because he was not trying to just replicate past successes. He didn't want this to be Space Quest 4 Part 2. He wanted to take it somewhere else. And he really spends a lot of time, and in my opinion, perhaps too much time, wondering, okay, the Space Quest fans, what do they really want from a game? And he kind of went in this direction where he said, all right, the Space Quest fans are a bit too complacent. They just expect Roger to bump around from planet to planet getting into mischief. What can we do to surprise them that won't take them out of their comfort zone? And his idea was that if we inject Roger into a human body, he can bounce around organs and different parts of the human body like it was a universe, like it was a galaxy. And in conceptually, that sounds like a fine idea. But in execution, through a number of different factors, not all of these are Josh Mandel's fault, obviously, but through the execution, it just falls apart for some reason.
Yeah. Well, it's not just for some reason. I think it's like, I do kind of think the idea of the Fantastic Voyage game is very sound. However, it's Space Quest that doesn't take place in space. That's kind of weird.
Except it actually does for most for half
of
the game.
Yes, of course. But
you're just sitting there going, when do I get into the human body? The box promised me the human body.
Yeah, but how many designers actually worked on the thing? And before departing, the Space Quest VI has this unfortunate thing where people started working on it and then just left the project and Sierra in general. And went through several iterations of those. So
should we get briefly into what actually happened with Space Quest VI?
Let's do that.
What actually happened was that 1995 was a shitty year for Sierra. People were coming and going. The company had just gone public, which meant they had stockholders and they had people to answer to. Before that, it was just a creative free for all where you could do whatever the fuck you wanted. And then different producers come in and they don't really know what the fuck an adventure game is. They just know it has to make money. And Space Quest VI went through, I think, three different producers before they settled on one guy who apparently didn't really know what he was doing and all of this stuff. And actually, halfway through the project, Josh Mandel left. He just up and left. He just went into the producer's office and went, fuck it, I quit. You guys can lick my ass. And he went off and he left all the design documentation to Scott Murphy, who at this point, up until this point, had been sort of a creative consultant type person. He had been busy doing programming for Police Quest 4, which went way over time and way over budget, and he was busy doing other shit. He didn't even really know that Space Quest 6 was in development. And Josh Mandel had already gotten the short end of the stick because he had been promised that he could do Space Quest 5, and him and Bruce Balfour had done all of these proposals for where to take Space Quest 5, and then Sierra just suddenly, out of the blue, just threw it at Dynamics, and he just went, all right, real. And then Space Quest 6 rolls around, and he, all right, now I get to do my Space Quest game. And then just shit starts piling onto this guy. It's actually amazing that Space Quest 6 came out at all, because it was just one huge clusterfuck of development. And yeah, basically what happens is that Josh leaves halfway through the project, Scott takes over the design reins and is left with all of Josh's design notes, and he's basically just thrust into the situation where he doesn't really want to be. He's got a game to finish that wasn't his game to begin with, really, and he's just sitting there going, right, I guess I have to finish this game, I guess. And that's what he did. And that's why, you know, half of the game is really, really very Josh Mandel-y, like I said. You can click on everything and, you know, all of this stuff. Half of the game is like that. And then the other half of the game is, you can really tell. It's done by a guy who was told to finish this game. Really, really finish this. And he's like, do I really have to? And then once the game comes out, the box says, this is a standout solo effort from Scott Murphy. And no one has been more apologetic about that little marketing snafu than Scott himself. He's apologized many times to Josh Mandel. He didn't know that the PR department were going to market this game as a Scott Murphy solo project. That was never the intention. So that's basically what happened to Space Quest 6. It was a clusterfuck.
Yeah, it really shows. I don't know, something about, I mean, the graphics are great, but something about it just rubs me the wrong way. I can't really quite place it. I mean, it's better than most Sierra SVGA games with cartoon graphics, especially better than Cube's Quest, you know, 7. It's one of those things where high-res Sierra games had that. I mean, I guess the King's Quest 7 and Torrent's Passage have that cartoony sort of look that's outsourced to many different animation departments. They kind of look similar, you know, including the infamous Animation Magic, the Russian studio that's trying to copy Disney. But there are some other unique standalone Sierra SVGA games. One of them is the Leisure Suit Larry 6. Which I love because it's one and only game that's basically what's his face? Shit, the artist. Skirvin. What's the name? Man.
Yeah, Bill Skirvin.
Bill Skirvin. So it's that style in SVGA.
Yeah, it looks
I think it's great. I mean, people hate it, but I think it's fucking amazing. And it has this sort of pop art look where scanned in items are placed on top of it and stuff like that. So that's that. And then Space Quest 6 has this sort of high-res animated sprites look combined with pre-rendered elements here and there for sprites and the backgrounds and everything. And although it's very solid and kind of consistent in many ways, I don't know what to do with it. To me, it just looks off. I don't know. It's a lot more consistent than either Torrent's Passage or Space. King's Quest 7.
Actually, I would disagree. Space Quest 6 looks really. It looks like it wants to be in two places at once. The background art is very. First of all, it was all hand-drawn on the computer instead of scanned-in graphics. That's one thing. And all the character animations are sort of cartoony. Comic bookish, but really cartoony, and the backgrounds are all these really sort of I'm not going to say dingy, but in a positive sense, they're kind of they kind of want to be Space Quest 4, but not so much, and it kind of becomes this clash between this sort of really gritty kind of style and then this cartoonish animation put on top. The reason for that, I suppose, is that most of the artists on Space Quest 6 came off Gabriel Knight, the first Gabriel Knight. Actually, the lead animator was a dude named Michael Hutchins, who was the lead animator for Gabriel Knight. And he, I guess, was basically not told what to do. he was just basically told to run with it. Right, here's the first four or five Space Quest games. Do whatever they did. And it just turns into this kind of really weird clash of art styles that don't really mesh together very well.
Yeah. I mean, I have, like I said, I don't like anything about it. Like, not just the graphical style. I'm not particularly fond of the puzzles, especially in the later half of the game where, you know, shit just falls apart completely. I'm not fond of the story at all. It just feels not Space Quest-y and I kind of question Roger's attachment to other people that was never explored before. I think the character of Roger changed drastically, not for the best. And you know, the overall cartoony fucking slapsticky angle that it takes is just I don't enjoy playing it. I don't even know when this is going to be the next time I'm going to revisit that game, if ever. I have it, it's on the shelf, and that's probably where it's going to end up. You?
It's weird because it's not even as slapsticky as Space Quest V, because Space Quest V is very visually orientated. It's very slapsticky actually, but it's cohesive. It's all the way through. It retains the style, and Space Quest VI just sort of jumps from the early Space Quest humor to Space Quest V kind of slapstick cartoony humor, What the fuck? I was gonna say something. You go ahead. I'll try to think of what I was gonna say.
That was it. Like I don't. My bottom line is I don't like it. I'll be really hard pressed to find any aspect of the game that I enjoy, despite it having some gags that I like and stuff like this. This is like really not enough for me to point at anything and be like, well, I kind of enjoy this. I kind of enjoy this. Nah, there's just those things are few and far between.
Yeah. It is kind of a mess, and it was kind of a mess behind the scenes, and you can sort of tell that it was a mess when it came out. You can also sort of tell, and I will say this in kind of its defense, you can tell it was a labor of love. Oh, right, I just remembered what I was going to say. I'll get to that. You can kind of tell it was a labor of love to begin with, and then shit just started piling on, and it just became a chore instead of being this labor of love that it was supposed to be. And here's what I was going to say. It does do one thing that really, really fundamentally changes the Space Quest humor. And I've mentioned this on the SpaceQuest.net forum. It is that the relationship between Roger and the narrator in particular is that for the first time ever, Roger is aware that he's in a computer game. It's not meta-humor in the sense that Space Quest 3 and Space Quest 4, where you're traveling through Space Quest time and where you're rescuing the two guys from Andromeda and all that. All of a sudden, he's very aware that he's actually in an adventure game. And he has conversations with the narrator, who's now all of a sudden a voice in his head. And I always thought that was so jarring, because now he's actually having arguments with the narrator instead of the narrator being this omnipresent figure that is basically just, you know, godlike and pokes fun at him for messing up, because the narrator knows what's going to happen later in the story. In Space Quest VI, it's like the narrator is a part of Roger, and it just makes you feel even more lost than you were supposed to. I remember Josh saying that people criticize Space Quest VI because it dumped you on polysorbate 60 with no clue as to what you were supposed to do. And his defense was, well, Space Quest IV dumps you in the middle of Xenon in Space Quest XII, and you have no idea what the fuck you're supposed to do. But at least you had an anchor in the narrator who was sort of guiding you in a very, you know, like an abusive parent through the story. And in Space Quest VI, he's just as bewildered as you are. So
I agree. I actually haven't thought of that, but now it does occur to me. I mean, it's been a while since I played that game. But yeah, so honestly, that's one Space Quest I'd recommend you kind of skip.
It does, however, bring back Gary Owens. Space Quest 5 never had a CD-ROM version. They were going to do one at one point, but Dynamics ran out of money, and they would rather, at the time, they would rather focus on building new games instead of polishing up existing games. So Space Quest V never had a CD-ROM version, which is a pity, because if any game actually deserved that,
it would be five. Yeah,
it had so much. It actually had a lot of really, really funny dialogue.
It would have been a game.
Yeah. Space Quest VI brought back voice actors, not very good voice actors, I'm afraid, but it did bring back voice actors, and it did bring back Gary Owens. God love him.
Yeah, I mean, play it. I mean, if you buy it in a pack on GOG, you know, give it a whirl. Not gonna hurt you, but. Personally, it's my least favorite Space Quest game. I'd rather play Space Quest 2 than 6.
Yes.
And it kind of serves, unfortunately, as a low point in the series. Like, so it's basically a sad end to the once mighty series of games. So that doesn't really help it.
But to sort of wrap up the whole Space Quest timeline, if we had ever gotten what was promised to be Space Quest VII, that would have been a whole new low. So in ways, we should be thankful that Space Quest VI came out and actually was, by and large, an adventure game, and it did have sarcastic humor, and it did feel Space Questy in places. Space Quest VII, the one that was proposed and which was being designed by Leslie Balfour and Scott Murphy, very much against their will, would have been atrocious.
To wrap up the whole Space Quest thing is like, you know, all games are DOS games. They're all currently available on Good Old Games, and you should buy them. It's still six games is still a lot. For a gaming series, and I mean, it's a pillar of you know, Sierra's sort of output. You know, that was one of their big major series, and you know, it's totally worth replaying. Yes, none of them are really perfect, but what Sierra games or what games are really right? But there is a big reason why it gathered that sort of following, not so much a cult following. I mean, it was a huge hit back in the day, but the following still remains to this day.
If you, in retrospect, if you buy the Space Quest games 1 through 6 and you sit down and play them, they're interesting in a sort of historical context. From a modern gameplay perspective, you're probably going to get frustrated. You're going to go, this is shitty gameplay. If you're in the wrong demographic, you're even going to go, this is shitty graphics, even though the graphics were amazing for their time. They're really frustrating, and we were talking about the game design philosophy. They're kind of all over the place in terms of fairness and in terms of gameplay and all this stuff. But they're very interesting from a historical point of view. And you should definitely pick them up. They're fantastic. And there's a reason why they still have a dedicated, devoted fan base to this day, which is that despite all of the nitty-gritty technical flaws we've been talking about, you know, timer puzzles and all of the shit, the air about them, the whole thing about them, the whole downtrodden sort of sarcastic thing, the anti-hero aspects, all of these sardonic, sarcastic elements really redefined science fiction comedy for computer games. Even to this day, science fiction in computer gaming still takes itself way too seriously. And Space Quest never took itself so seriously. It was the punk rock of adventure games. That's my opinion anyway.
This really brings us to the end of the whole Space Quest thing. So yeah, buy them, play them, love them, wait for Space Ventures. This is basically it. Anything else you'd like to pimp out, sir, while we have the time?
I do a competing podcast with poor old Anatoly here. I hope I pronounced that correctly. Called The Space Quest Historian, which is currently on hiatus, but we're gearing up to do season 2 of the podcast. It's gotten some pretty positive response so far. And, you know, all of the Space Quest community sort of rallied behind the Space Venture, and they're now, you know, everyone was kind of comatose for, 10 or 15 or 20 years or whatever, how long it was since Space Quest kind of died out. They're all kind of back in the game again. And it's really been, you know, with social media and all this stuff that's been invented in the meantime, it's really been very gratifying to see the Space Quest community coming together once again and rallying behind the Space Venture. So I foresee many great things happening. Even though, you know, some games have come out that have been kickstarted, adventure games have come out, and they've received a lot of flack for being nostalgic and for not pushing things forward in the sense. I will say that the two guys from Andromeda are very acutely aware that they're not going to repeat past mistakes. They're not going to have another Skaterama sequence in there. They're not going to. It's going to be palatable not only to adventure game fans but also to newcomers without pandering to the trigger fingy kind of modern gaming public. This is not going to be a Walking Dead thing all over again. I'm sorry, Telltale, but it's not going to be one of those pseudo adventure games. This is going to be an actual proper adventure game. So I'm very much looking forward to that, and I'm not just saying that because I'm on the team. Even if I wasn't, I would still be pissing my pants with joy.
While we're slightly off the topic of the Space Quest Historian, while in its very short run as the video series, I have actually participated in one where I sound really bored and just shitty like I normally am. So if you actually do a search for Space Quest Historian on YouTube, we didn't cover it here. The situation with the adventure games being translated in Russia is very different from the rest of the world. So if you're kind of interested in how translation and everything was done and in relation to Space Quest series is actually covered. Well, it's two angles are covered. The sort of the official releases overseas that are not in English on the side of Germany, and completely unofficial releases from the side of, behind the Iron Curtain.
Actually, there are four episodes, and you're in the last one. It's called Foreign Quests.
Anything else?
No. If you want to follow me on Twitter at your own risk, you can do that. It's at Torben Frost. Don't ask me why. That's a long story, but it's TorbenFrost. Drop by the spacequest.net forums if you want to poke around there and have fun with the Space Quest fans. I'm on there too. And pretty much just look forward to the Space Venture. It's going to be fucking awesome.
I'm waiting. I'm a backer, so I'm waiting. And you, of course, wonderful people can follow me on Twitter at DustNostalgic, that you probably are already. You can find me anywhere where you can Google DustNostalgia. Eventually will lead to me, and if you have a topic for a podcast, contact me, preferably on Twitter, but just about anywhere else will do. And you could be here one day talking about something about DOS games that you like. Sir, it's been a pleasure having you here on a podcast. Maybe one day you can come back and we'll talk about something else. Who knows?
Yes. I do have a lot. Every time I listen to your podcast, I'm always going, right, wait, I have something to say. And then I realize I'm listening to a pre-recorded thing. So I would very much love to come on and talk about something other than Space Quest, because I do play other games as well, as my friend at the Upper Memory Block podcast will know. So that would be it's been an absolute pleasure, sir. Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you to all of you for listening. Hopefully, there'll be more episodes of the Dust Nostalgia podcast coming, and there will be. Trust me, I have a few plans. So hopefully, you listened all the way to the end. I know those get quite lengthy, but whatever. So we'll hear each other again on the next episode of the Dust Nostalgia podcast. Goodbye.
Bye bye.